The existence of enemies is a painful reality of the faithful Christian, but not one that should really surprise us. Jesus had enemies, the Jewish leaders, Judas, and of course Satan himself all opposed Jesus and sought his ultimate failure and demise. The world hated Jesus, and because it hated him, it hates his people. Jesus said in John 15 verses 18 and 19, "If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love itself. Yet because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you." John would later write, "Do not marvel, my brethren, if the world hates you," 1 John 3 and verse 13. Christians are lights shining in a world of darkness, Matthew 5:16, and darkness by its very nature hides the light. Therefore, it follows naturally that those who walk in darkness would do everything within their power to fight against and extinguish the light. But how should we deal with those who hate and fight against us? Well, the carnal person typically seeks the demise of his enemies. He desires to completely defeat and overwhelm them. But God's people live by a higher standard, and therefore we must deal with our enemies in a different way. Today, we're going to briefly consider three contexts of Scripture which speak to the relationship that we have with our enemies. The combined thought of these passages is overwhelmingly clear. God's desire is that we love those who hate us, and that we strive to convert them from our enemies to our brethren. First, consider with me Matthew chapter 5, verses 38 through 42. Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person, but whoever slaps you on the right cheek, turn the other to him also. If anyone wants to sue you and take away your tunic, let him have your cloak also. And whoever compels you to go 1 mile, go with him 2. Give to him who asks you, and from him who wants to borrow from you, do not turn away." The examples that Jesus referenced had great meaning to every person in his audience. A slap to the right cheek would be a backhanded blow, a great sign of disrespect in the time of the New Testament. The cloak was an outer garment that was used for warmth and even bedding at times when they were out in the open, such as shepherds out in a field. Roman soldiers had the ability to compel a person to carry a load for them up to 1 mile. Well, Jesus commanded more. He says, go the extra mile. Each of these items illustrates God's desire for his people to forego retaliation. Now, such is difficult and often contrary to our nature as human beings. Retaliation is often our initial inclination, but Jesus forbids that kind of reaction and commands something far more impactful. Our second passage flows logically from the first, providing the positive reaction that is to be coupled with the negative. In Matthew 5 and verse 44, Jesus said, "Love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you." The conventional wisdom of the day suggested love for those who love you, meaning your neighbor, and hatred for those who hate you, your enemy. Jesus turned that wisdom on its head by commanding us to love all people, and especially those who do not love you in return. I want you to notice the four imperatives in the passage: love, bless, do good, and pray. Each of these suggests actions with love as the foundation. To love someone is to desire their best interest, and that desire should always be coupled with action. It's easy to seek the best interest of those who seek our best interest. Even tax collectors do that, Matthew 5:46. However, it is very difficult to actively seek good for someone who only seeks our harm. Yet that's exactly what Jesus tells us to do in this context. Now, practically speaking, what does it mean to love our enemies and forego retaliation against them? Well, we see the answer in Romans 12, verses 17 through 21. "Repay no one evil for evil. Have regard for good things in the sight of all men. If it is possible, as much as depends on you, live peaceably with all men. Beloved, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath, for it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord. Therefore, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him a drink. For in doing so, you will heap coals of fire on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Friends, ultimately what we say is that our goal must not be the ultimate demise of our enemies, but instead their goodwill and their salvation. Friends, we thank you for joining us for our program today, and have a blessed day.